Today on ArtScene we'll feature Youth on Record, Duct-work, an urban mural project,
a music video from a local Denver band,
and guitarist Casey Hrdlicka. Youth on Record. It's a local nonprofit dedicated to helping underserved youth achieve their best through music. Hi, I'm Bobby Lefebvre, and welcome to ArtScene.
We are on our way, finding ourselves every day. We are on our way, finding ourselves page by page.
All right, so I'm here with Jamie Duffy, Executive Director of Youth on Record. Jamie, thank you for having us here.
Thanks for being here.
Sure. So, hey, talk to us a little bit about Youth on Record's history and how you guys got started.
Sure. So we were actually founded by three members of the Colorado band Flowbots, all of whom went to Denver Public Schools. And this was in 2007. They really wanted to harness the power of music and the energy behind it, not just for music's sake, but to get people involved in their local community, to get them civically engaged. So really, we were a seed idea about how to use music and the arts to create positive social change.
Absolutely. Yeah. And who are your programs geared toward? Who do you engage?
So right now, close to about 35-36% of our students in Denver Public Schools are not graduating on time. Mm-hmm. Most people don't know that and aren't aware of that. Now, of course, when we're talking about young people of color and young people who live below the poverty line, those numbers of students who aren't completing are much higher.
Yeah.
So our programs are actually geared towards older students in the district. Our kids are typically between the ages of 16 and 21. They're the oldest in Denver Public Schools with the least amount of high school credits.
Okay.
And over 90% of our students are students of color.
Wow.
So we're working with about 1,000 teenagers a year now. Before Youth on Record, our students who were knocking at the door were chronically truant. And they're not gonna get up on a Friday morning for early class, but they are gonna get up for that class if their teacher is Diego Flores and Mace Windu and Bianca McCann and Susie Q. Smith. I mean, yeah. These legends in our town,
yeah.
Those are who their music instructors are. And so that's one way, is just being super engaging, unbelievably culturally relevant.
Mm-hmm.
I can't stress that enough. I think that especially in a school district which is predominantly young people of color, we have to make sure that their instructors get that, mm-hmm. are either from their same backgrounds or have a connection to those backgrounds. I think that makes a world of difference.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, it's really interesting you say that, because that type of thing could be the difference between a kid being suspended for something that maybe an instructor doesn't understand,
yep.
and, you know, really a mentor opportunity. Talk to us about this amazing space.
Totally.
And sort of what is housed here at Youth on Record.
Yeah. You know, I love this neighborhood. So we're sitting here in the La Alma Lincoln Park neighborhood of West Denver. The only neighborhood in our city that has both a Spanish and English name, appropriately, the Sol, La Alma. And we are part of the Denver Housing Authority's redevelopment project here. So I always tell people, when you're driving down 10th and you're coming into this new redevelopment, the first thing you might think is like, another gentrified neighborhood. But the truth is, this neighborhood and this development has been very thoughtful about the things that we would hope all developers would be thoughtful about. So they were extremely thoughtful about retention, increasing Section 8 housing, increasing affordable housing, and then being realistic about growth in the city. So there's market rate here too. It's really become, I think, what we're all so hungry for, mm-hmm. which is a creative, artistic, multi-generational hub. It's a safe space. But it's cool, you know? Have you ever been to sort of like a youth center that clearly a bunch of nerdy adults designed it?
I have, actually.
Yes, yeah. We've all been there.
I have.
I mean, this is just so teenage inspired. Even the artwork you see behind us, I mean, it's them, it's who they are, it's their identities.
That's great. Well, what is your favorite part about being the executive director here at Youth on Record?
My favorite part, you know, I think it was Mark Twain who said, the two best days of your life are the day you're born and the day you figure out why. Mm-hmm. And for me, my heart has always been deeply connected to art and social justice movements and spirituality. Yeah. And this is a fascinating combination of art and social justice.
You know, and it seems like, obviously, it's about the music, it's about the programming,
sure.
But it also appears like that's sort of the tool or the
totally.
To really do the work that you're talking about, the social justice work,
yep.
the mentorship work,
yep.
the youth development work,
yep.
the community building. So the music and the program is sort of, it appears to me, a tool to do these other larger things
yeah.
that are going to have a ripple effect on the community.
Totally, Bobby. We just happen to believe that art is one of the most powerful tools for enacting social change. And I'll give you an example. So I always tell our students when I have the chance that when a totalitarian regime, or let's say like a fascist regime, takes over in any nation, the first thing they do is burn down the museums, take the art out, outlaw music. If that doesn't show you how powerful mm-hmm. those things are, I don't know what does.
Yeah. Well, Jamie, thank you for
Thanks,
having
Bobby.
Us.
Thanks,
Bobby.
Thanks for
everything. I always appreciate chatting with you.
Of course.
It's been good. We'll have more with Youth on Record later in the show. And next, we're going to check out an unusual local art project, Duct-work. A hidden landmark, slated for demolition. A group of local urban artists. With spray cans or paintbrushes in hand, they create temporary testaments to their community, under a bridge. The I-70 viaduct between Colorado Boulevard and Brighton Boulevard is coming down as part of an expansion program to replace the aging infrastructure.
For so many years, these viaducts have been such an eyesore to this community, and they've just become part of this landscape, almost like an urban decay. These were built in the 1940s, and they're well past their shelf life. People come through here on a daily basis, and it's a very, very drab drag. Most times, there's a lot of graffiti on the walls that the city of Denver has to mitigate.
Oh, I think we're returning safety and art and color and beauty to this stretch of 46th Avenue underneath the viaduct, and I think it's a sign of the change that's coming. It's the same sort of spirit and beauty we'd like to bring to the project in the future when we revitalize and change I-70.
On a day in late 2016, the public was invited to an event which brought together the artists and community to witness Duct-work. The project is designed to bring murals to one stretch of the viaduct from Brighton Boulevard to York Street. Hundreds of visitors came, some perhaps to celebrate, some perhaps to mourn, but all to watch the transformation. There was music and vendors and even a wall for kids to create murals of their own.
That idea to bring this all about actually came from the CDOT end. We thought we'd bring this corridor back to the community. This is a stretch of road that has been pretty dark and depressing for a long time. So we had the idea, but it took a whole bunch of people to make it happen. So the Urban Arts Fund was instrumental in providing the original seed funding, and then sponsors came to the table, and it just kind of blossomed after that. This is a place that could use some love. It's a tremendous amount of concrete that's sort of been begging for color for years. And so we've got some tremendous artists out here who wanted to give their time and really turn this back into a work of beauty.
I really love this space and the community aspect of this project. My piece that I wanted to do is inspired by a photo of my sister. It's kind of like a dream scene. I just wanted to have something that people would like, and I mean, I know that this part of I-70 is coming down, so it's nice to just make it beautiful for the time that it'll still be up.
I mean, it's a bad thing, you know, for the people that are getting pushed out, but I think they need to renovate this too at the same time, so. It's great canvas surfaces. It's a great place to put some art up. Definitely needs it down here. Most everything's temporary anyway, so. We get the picture real quick and then we're good.
I, as a public artist, I've come to accept that my work is temporary, so I don't mind at all. I like the correlation between street art and life, where everything is just temporary. I've heard that this work will probably be up for about a year or two, and that's a very good length of time for a piece that's gonna run outside. We've had people come through and thank us for beautifying the neighborhood and adding some life down here.
I'm pretty used to work being temporary. that's the nature of the beast out in the streets. Nothing lasts forever out here. So I think utilizing this space that's kind of been, for lack of a better word, abandoned, like not, you don't get much foot traffic through here, you know what I mean? Like, it's cool to bring a little more life, a little more foot traffic to an area that's kind of like dying out. You know, there's gonna be a lot of changes, and there already is a lot of changes going on in Denver, but this area in particular, I think public art is very impactive. It raises awareness about things, it inspires people, it brightens the neighborhood, unifies different types of cultures. It can do all types of things. It's very, very powerful.
It's a win-win for artists because you're able to get a lot of great art on the walls, artists get to use it for their portfolio, and you know the community gets to enjoy it as public art. You know, you don't have to walk into a gallery or a museum to see art on your everyday journey home to work. These bridges are eventually going to get torn down here in the next few years, and what a great place to have some artists come together and use these urban canvases, so to speak.
Yes, the Viaduct is coming down, but not yet. For now, it's a new gallery of art, Beauty Under a Bridge. Next time you're in the area, be sure to check out the art before it's gone. And now, let's find out more about Youth on Record.
I'ma be the greatest, ooh mama we made it. Writing lines on these pages, days up in the basement, recording inside the shack, at it like every night. Halo under my mind, with trophies under my belt, with music that saved my life, devil can tell a lie. Let me tell you a story, let me show you my glory. Let me run from temptation, the studio, the safe haven. Reason the pen racing, reason I kept training, no worries I'm elevated.
All right, so we're here with Mace, who's a program coordinator here at Youth on Record. Mace, talk to us about what you do here at Youth on Record.
I handle all of our out-of-school programming, such as Open Lab, which is the day we're here on today. And then I'm also a partner artist with Youth on Record, so I teach at North Valley and Collegiate Prep Academy during the week. Yeah, I'm just that guy that just handles stuff at the space.
Yeah, so that's a big, big job. So how did you become involved in Youth on Record?
I was a student of Youth on Record at a school called Respect Academy that's inside of Lincoln High School. I quickly became like an intern, and then I started running open labs, and then went to partner artist, and now I'm on staff. So I started as a student.
That's a really cool story. So you talk about open labs. Talk to us a little bit more about what open lab is and some of the other programming that Youth on Record offers.
Open lab is every Friday and Saturday from 11 to 3 when our students, community, and youth could come in outside of classes and work on their projects, learn how to play an instrument, record. It's also a time for us to serve youth that are not enrolled in our classes in the high schools. So, you know, we try to give them a chance to come in, use our space, learn what we're teaching.
What a cool job. Talk to us about how this creativity and how your talent is being used to empower young people.
I think being such a young partner artist gives me like a totally different perspective, especially being a teacher in high school when our students are only a few years younger than me. But I think the coolest thing about Youth on Record is that not only myself, but every partner artist here comes from the same places that our students do. And we're not just all talk, we're not just all textbook, we're real, living, working artists and musicians in Colorado.
Yeah, and you're a really cool testament to what this program does. Do you have any examples of any success stories or any, you know, one particular event or something that really sticks out to you that makes you say, hey, look, this is why we do the work, this is what is important?
I see that like every day, man, like every classroom that I teach in, I see that. It's not in particular, it's something that just happens like every day on a daily basis, especially teaching students. You could see the difference from when you walk into that classroom on the first day to the day you leave. Our motto is empowerment through creative education. And I think it's just different than any other classroom. It's kind of like a stress reliever while earning credits at the same time. Our goal is to make them graduate but give them a different mindset from when they leave, because I feel like a lot of students in these classes don't know what they're going to do with their future.
Sure.
And don't get me wrong, a big majority of them already knows what they want to do, but once we come in and show them that they have community, they have people who are here to empower them, their whole perception on kind of like their life changes. They want to do something creative.
You know, we're losing arts education and even the arts in schools. And so what role do you think that arts and culture play in helping develop young people?
I think it's just like therapeutic in general. They just latch on to life in a different way. Because without the arts, that leaves us without creative ways to like express ourselves in school. And when you don't have that positive expression, you tend to express yourself in different ways that are not positive.
Are the kids really excited when they come here?
Yeah, I mean, it's a free space for them to learn music. When you go into a different studio, man, you have to pay like $500 plus an hour to get in. So like sometimes you have all these aspiring artists who want to do this stuff, but to them it's just not a reachable goal because you don't have the money for that, everything.
Sure.
But they come in here and it's just like, I have this space now, I could create music.
Well, hey man, congratulations on all your success and all that you're doing here at Youth on Record. Thanks for chatting with us.
Cool, yeah.
We'll have more with Youth on Record later in the show. And now, let's take a look at a music video from one of Denver's own bands.
I'ma need a FaceTime, get online and Skype me. Who will be showing a party?
Yeah, most likely.
I'm in the mood to make you yahoos. And then letter you right back, it'll be like that. Then we can eye check. Hotmail, you can hotmail me. No reason for you to fight back. Apple girl, you can bite that. You can privately tweet me through PCs. I never lie.
Never lie.
I stay back. Found me on MySpace and my place. Within MySpace, got the worst case. My digital girl, she wants me in the worst way. So,
I'll be my digital.
My spirit show, that you get physical. My lyrical,
I'll be my
my digital. Got my spiritual. Got to get physical. My lyrical.
We'll be back with more great local arts on the other side. Stick around. Another great aspect of Youth on Record's programming is sessions with national touring artists. Today in the studio is the Saratogues. Another great place to learn to play an instrument is Swallow Hill Music. They're open to all ages and all abilities. One of their teachers, guitarist Casey Hrdlicka, recently visited with Michael Gadlin in the studio. Let's listen.
So what got you started? When did you pick up this thing?
My father played guitar, and okay. So always watching him growing up, always being really into music as a very young child.
Talk a little bit about your new band, and what kind of music is this? Because from what I read, you play different styles, all kinds
of.
What is this mainly? What can you tell me about the new CD?
My primary group is my 10-piece Afrobeat group named Atomga.
So when our guests get a chance, they need to really check this out.
It's a big variety band with a 3-piece horn section, percussion.
Wow.
We got a keyboardist, I'm on guitar.
What's your history with Swallow Hill Music?
They're a wonderful organization and really helped me to excel and make this a full-time thing.
And so they also have a platform for community and teaching, am I right?
I'm a teacher at Swallow Hill. Nice. They also put on concerts. They do a lot of stuff at the Arvada Center and Botanic Garden concerts.
Give us a solo. Let's hear you play.
Great. I'm gonna do a song that I wrote called Burning Bridges. It's kind of a Spanish surfer rock infused sort of tune.
Love it. Thank you.
All right, so I'm here with Diego Flores, who's a partner artist here at Youth on Record, as well as Deandra and Micah. Thank you guys for chatting with us. So we just had like a little session, huh? We had a little, what do you guys call that, what you guys just did?
A jam session.
A jam session?
Ooh. Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Totally. So every Friday, Open Lab happens here, our open programming. So we try to open it up and try to get every student to explore a different instrument and a different part of music.
Yeah. So what does it mean to you guys to be able to come into this cool room and play these instruments? Deandra, you were on the drums. You guys are both on the drums earlier. So what are you guys learning here?
Music theory, obviously, you know, because that's the class. And also basically finding your, how you could express yourself through the music, you know. I'm a producer, you know, I'd learned how to make beats and all that stuff. And I didn't know that before I got here.
Yeah.
I'm learning instruments that I didn't know. I just barely found out how to play the piano, barely, you know?
Yeah.
But good enough to play with a jam session, so.
Sure.
Yeah.
And Deandra, what do you like about being here at Youth on Record?
It's amazing. Like, there's so much equipment here that you could do. And then, like, especially if you're really into music, you could really put your stuff out here.
Yeah.
And it's cool because you don't have to pay for it.
That's
like,
awesome.
Like, the time.
Really cool. And Diego, I've known you for a long time. Diego is an amazing poet, he's a musician, and now he's a partner artist mentoring youth here at Youth on Record. What's your favorite part about working with young people?
It gives me a person to ask questions to.
Say more about that.
I'm a musician full-time, a poet full-time, and in the creative industry, I feel like there are our peers, you know, like I went to Bobby like, yo, like check out this poem, you know, check this out, you know. It's like a whole new audience, you know, it's like they can tell you exactly what they felt from it, you know.
So I know Diego is a pretty cool dude. What is it like having someone like Diego be your instructor for class?
All right, so I had Diego since...
And no pressure, right? Because he's your teacher, right?
No pressure at all. See, Diego's not just my teacher, though. He's, you know, he's my homie. He's my mentor, you know.
Yeah.
Youth on Record and, you know, Diego in general, they gave me a lot of opportunities with everything, pretty much. You know, musically, with poetry, all that, you know, like, I performed, I've been able to, or, you know, like, they just helped me a lot, you know. And Diego, you know, that's my homie. You know, he's been the closest one I got to through it this whole time, you know. If there's something I need to touch up on a song or on a beat, he'll be there and he'll help me out. You know, I learn something new every day, pretty much.
So, mm-hmm. So it's cool because it's like a community, a general community where you guys are helping each other. There's mentorship happening here, but there's also...
Yeah, it's really great to like get another musician's like point of view of your stuff and like actually be able to tell another musician about it instead of like rapping to your friend and they're like, oh yeah, that was cool.
Yeah.
And like they don't respect the music that much, you know? So it's like great to be in the same area as everybody who like enjoys the music just as much as you do.
Yeah. So Deandra, before you came to Youth on Record, did you play an instrument? Were you involved in music? Yeah, what did you do?
I like writing songs. Like I want to be a music producer and I want to rap.
Mm-hmm.
And I also played the clarinet for 3 years
mm-hmm.
in like middle school and elementary.
Diego, you got some great students here, man.
Definitely, they teach me a lot.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm a student all the time.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for meeting with us. Best of luck to you in everything that you pursue. Keep writing, keep producing, keep inspiring, and congrats. If you've ever wanted to play an instrument, or sing, or dance, or write, follow your passion. We'll see you next time when we discover more of Denver's art scene.